In just 1 year, Stacey Abrams has gone from being a little known but highly accomplished state legislator to a nationally known political rock star. She narrowly lost the Georgia gubernatorial election by a mere 18,000 votes, just one half of one percentage point.
Wow.
While Stacey may be best known for her historic campaign, she's been working on justice and civil engagement issues for much of her professional life in government, business, and the nonprofit sectors. She was a Georgia state legislator from 2007 until 2017, when she resigned from serving as minority leader of the legislature. There, she was known for her thorough work, especially on taxation and education issues, and for her ability to work effectively across the aisle. Her work has been widely recognized by groups as different as organized labor and chambers of commerce, including the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. The list of her awards would take the entire half hour to read. It's interesting to note that she caught Ebony Magazine's eye in 2001 when she was listed as a future leader. Good looking out, Ebony. Stacey is also a romance novelist. She sold over 100,000 of those books. She describes her most recent book, Minority Leader, How to Build Your Future and Make Real Change, as part memoir, part advice, and part alchemy. Stacey Abrams is a proud graduate of Spelman College, the LBJ School of Public Affairs at the University of Texas, and Yale University Law School. Stacey, welcome to Malveaux. This is my very first show, and you're my very first guest.
Well, I'm honored to be the inaugural guest. Thank you for having me.
Of course. I want to talk a little bit about your book. We have a lot of stuff to talk about, but I want to start with your book because it is so transparent, so audacious, so bold. And you say part memoir, part advice, and part alchemy. One of the things you reveal in your book is that you're an introvert. I don't believe you. How can a politician as engaging as you be an introvert?
So when people think about introversion versus extroversion, or I think as you describe yourself, an ambivert, introversion means you find people interesting, but you don't get, it takes energy.
It's exhausting. Energizing, but exhausting.
Exactly. And for extroverts, they draw energy from that engagement. I spend a lot of time alone because I like people, but I like quiet. I like contemplation, but I also like getting things done. And yeah, I'm the second of six kids. I learned early to navigate large groups of people because that's called dinner time. But I also know that to conserve my energy and to be ready for the next day, I've got to respect the fact that I need alone time. But one of the things I learned in politics is that what I want most is for good to happen. I want people to have better lives. I want to eradicate poverty. And the only way to get there is to run for office in this way. For me, in the public service space, being in politics is the way to do it. And you want people to believe you. You want people to trust you. And that means you've got to share something of yourself. And so each day is me working to share more of myself so that people can trust that what I do is for their benefit.
You know, one of the things about your book is that you really talk about confronting your fears. Mm-hmm. You talk about, and you challenge. I mean, the book has worksheets at the end of every chapter for others to basically test themselves in the same way that you tested yourself. But you challenge folks to basically face their fears and to power through them. When you first announced that you were running for office, I'm going to be really candid. I mean, I liked you. I'd met you. I'm like, that girl tripping. I'm in Georgia, yeah. A southern state. Mm-hmm. You know, of course, when you won the primary, suddenly you got a lot of attention. But that period between announcing, hearing people who you looked up to, your mentors and others, other black politicians, mm-hmm. basically giving you the no sign, between that time and winning the primary, how did you deal with that? Because it had to be crippling at some point.
It's very affecting and it's disappointing. But I'd been in politics for a long time and I've often tried things that seemed anathema to others. When I stood to be Democratic leader in 2010, I had only been in the legislature 4 years. And there were a number of folks who told me, you haven't been here long enough, you don't know enough, and you're not nice enough. I didn't spend a lot of time going out to bars or glad handing on the floor. And there was a deep concern that I just wasn't friendly enough. And what I would tell people is I may not be friendly in the way you're used to, but my approach works too. I was quietly supportive of a number of my colleagues. I did the work. And when it came time to run for governor, I knew I'd done the work and I knew I had a strategy because I didn't just wake up and decide to run. I'd spent time building relationships across the state as Democratic leader. I'd already visited 150 of 159 counties. I'd helped legislators across the caucus, but I'd also worked across the aisle. And I'd done the work of registering more than 200,000 people of color to vote in the state of Georgia. I'd worked with organizations. So I knew I had the building blocks. Part of the challenge was convincing those who thought they knew that I was right. And yes, it's hard. It's hard and it's hurtful, especially people that have known you since you were in college, who looked at me and said, well, I think you're so smart, and I think you're the most qualified, but you're a black woman. And they would whisper it to me like they were telling me
like
a secret.
Yeah.
I'm like, I've noticed. Yeah, thanks.
So I've been in the mirror lately.
Yeah.
So you've become this political rock star, literally. I mean, you lost this. I don't even think you lost. I mean,
I
neither
agree.
Do you, for that matter. It took you a week to not concede, as you noted, but to acknowledge that technically Mr. Kemp had enough votes. Right. Losing by 18,000 votes when more than 55,000 were thrown out has a cut like a knife. Are you angry or are you bitter or how are you processing that?
So I want to frame this properly. So 18,000 votes was the vote margin to get to a runoff. 54,700 votes was the difference, the final tally. And we know that he suppressed votes by purging more than 1.5 million voters. We know that he held up 53,000 votes using an illegal exact match process. We know that he shut 214 polling places. We know that under his leadership, counties threw out absentee ballots. And we know that overall, this was not a fair fight. And yes, I'm angry. But I'm angry in a righteous way, because that means not that I lost, it means that Georgians lost. Their votes were not counted. They did not have the right to participate in their democracy. And that should enrage all of us, Democrat and Republican and Independent. And so for me, yes, I'm a little bitter, but I think bitterness is it can be a galvanizing force. I'm mad, but I'm mad on behalf of others. But most of all, I'm energized because I'm going to make certain that there are fair fights in Georgia. We started an organization for that purpose.
I was on your website yesterday. So it's fairfight.org, I believe.
So fairfightaction.org.
There are stories upon stories on the Fair Fight website about the people who had various denials. A group of us was in Georgia the week after the election, and we couldn't go anywhere without someone telling us a story of an absentee ballot not counted, someone who didn't get a receipt, which they're supposed to give you a receipt for your ballot, and all of that. So Fair Fight has filed a lawsuit against the state of Georgia. What's the status of that right now?
So let me correct myself. So our website, our organizational name is Fair Fight Action, but Fair Fight Georgia is the website. If you just put in Fair Fight Georgia, it'll pull it up. We filed the lawsuit in the middle of December. It is a comprehensive, systemic attack on voter suppression. We, during the course of the election, filed, between that November 6th and November 16th period, filed four different lawsuits. We won 3.5. The one provision we didn't win, unfortunately, state law did not allow for us to get a remedy, but we were able to compel the Secretary of State to do better. And what we've said is that because of all of these pieces that I mentioned, there is a systemic disenfranchisement happening in Georgia that is reminiscent of Jim Crow, and that we cannot allow the state of Georgia to move backwards in terms of democracy. We're in federal court. We will start the process this year, and our goal is to force strong legal reforms to the election process in the state of Georgia and hopefully use this as a predicate for larger revisiting of the Voting Rights Act.
Well, this isn't just happening in Georgia. It's happening all over the country.
Exactly.
We saw the same thing in Florida. We've seen it in Alabama. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has appointed Congresswoman Marsha Fudge to look at reforms of the Voting Rights Act. What would you like to see happen?
I think we need to restore the Voting Rights Act, and I think that we have to update it to reflect the current behavior that is voter suppression. Because it isn't just what happened in Georgia. It's the fact that in North Dakota, Native Americans who live on reservations who are assigned P.O. boxes were suddenly told with weeks to go that they had to have street addresses which are not available. It's the voter registration third-party issues that occur in Texas where third-party groups are limited in how they can register voters. We have to think about voter suppression as registration, access, and counting. Those three pieces have to be addressed, and our goal is to use the lawsuit to build the case that John Roberts said needed to be made. The Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, when they gutted Section 5, he said that there is no proof that it's necessary. Well, we want to provide the proof.
And North Carolina is another state
Absolutely.
That we need to look at. Have you looked at that case at all?
We have. So that's the, I think it's the 9th Congressional District,
yes.
Mark Harris, who's not being seated right now. And I think that's the right decision. Because we also have to understand that voter suppression and electoral fraud go hand in hand. There is no voter fraud. Voter fraud assumes that people are trying to vote when they shouldn't. That is a rare occurrence, and often it, because
this is a fraction of a percentage
point? It's a fraction of a percentage point, and it's often mistakes. It's people who don't understand what the rules are because they differ not only from state to state, but county to county, community to community. And so we have to recognize that Georgia, America doesn't have an overvoting problem. We have a voter access problem. We have a voter engagement problem. And those are things that can be solved by making democracy easier. And that's what H.R. 1, the bill that the Democratic Congress put forward on the first day of the 116th Congress, that's what that will accomplish. Automatic voter registration, same-day registration in case there's a problem, but also creating more unification in how democracy is administered across this country. Your democracy shouldn't change based on arbitrary lines if you cross from county to county or state to state.
So Florida restored the voting rights for 1.4 million, I believe, former returning citizens, formerly convicted felons. Is that underway for Georgia as well?
So Georgia already allows ex-offenders who have satisfied their fines and fees and restitution to be restored. The challenge in Georgia is just the complicated process of actually getting that restoration. There's an organization called the Georgia Justice Project that's been working on this for years. And it would take an effective governor to actually implement a unifying standard to make certain that people who have these rights can exercise their rights. So, but unlike Florida, there was no constitutional prohibition against restoration
of
the franchise.
So you actually have to appeal to get your right back then?
You don't have to appeal, but you have to go through a process to demonstrate that you've met all of the criteria. And those criteria are sometimes very vague and complicated for people to understand.
One of the other things that your opponent and now I guess governor, I say I guess governor, Mr. Kemp did was scrub the rolls.
Yes.
So that if you hadn't been, there was one person on your website who said he was an episodic voter. Mm-hmm. He remembered voting in 8. He wasn't sure whether he voted in 12 or not. And when he went to try to vote, he was not allowed to.
Right.
Other states have done this scrubbing because I guess people of color, liberals, are more likely to be episodic voters than sort of the tried and true other folks. Would you have a prohibition in general against scrubbing, or would there be another way to approach getting rid of that?
So voter purging, purging voters is ostensibly designed to clean the rolls. And Democrats actually passed a law in Georgia in 1997 that permitted this process. The challenge is how aggressively it's used and how effectively it's communicated. Unfortunately, Ohio had a case that went to the Supreme Court just in 2018, and the court said that voter purging is permissible. Our argument in our lawsuit is that standalone purging might not be a bad thing, although I do believe you should not be removed from the rolls unless you move from the place or you die.
What's the rationale for scrubbing?
The rationale, and I think it's a false one, is that you want to make certain the people voting are eligible to vote. And one of the metrics is, well, if you haven't voted, it may be proxy for you having died or having moved. But I think your point is exactly the right one. It is also proxy for, I don't believe that this election is one that I want to participate in. And democracy allows non-participation. And so I do believe that as a fundamental standard, voter purging is wrong if it uses as a metric whether or not you've cast a ballot in recent elections. And let's think about this. In Georgia, we have an election every year, by and large. You have municipal elections in odd years, and then you have congressional and state legislative races in even years, and then presidential and congressional elections. People aren't required by American law to vote. We're not Australia. We don't have mandatory voting. And then to say that because you do not do something we haven't told you you must do, you don't have the right to do it when you're ready. That's fundamentally a mismatch with what democracy should allow.
Absolutely. It's really very challenging to look at, as you say, county by county, state by state, all the laws are different. Mm-hmm. And it's something of a quagmire. There was a woman who was prosecuted for voting because she had a felony, but in another county where she lived before, it was okay for people with felonies to vote.
So in different states, you can cross state lines. And that's my point. You've got 50 different states. You've got, I mean, Georgia itself has 159 counties. And in Georgia, you could live in Gwinnett County and live next door to DeKalb County. Your absentee ballot counts differently. because of how they treat whether you sign the back and whether you put the date in the right place. And so we had thousands of ballots that were rejected as absentee ballots because Gwinnett County refused to allow a small minor infraction that DeKalb County would allow. People who were voting because they didn't realize that if you lived in Oklahoma and moved to Texas, the rules are different. There should be no different rules for democracy in America. You are an American citizen, therefore your democracy should be consistent and understandable and should not be a complicated set of hurdles. And that's what we're fighting for. We're fighting for what we promise, which is an American experience of democracy that is real and true and consistent. And that's what we should have.
Can we clean this up by 2020?
No. I think that what we can do by 2020 is mitigate the harms that we see. And we should add a new one to it. Just a few days ago, the Third Circuit struck down the consent decree that since 1982 has prevented the Republican National Committee from engaging in what's called ballot security. That's when they would stand outside or challenge the allowability of some citizens to cast their ballots. That is no longer prohibited. And now the Republican Party with its entire apparatus can engage in a process of essentially intimidating voters.
So this is what the Klan used to do when black people would go to vote, is stand there to ensure that if you work for Massa, you didn't vote or someone noticed you voting and then you lost your job.
I don't know what the RNC plans to do with this newfound power, but I do know it's dangerous. And I know that in concert with the other examples of voter suppression that are so pervasive across this country, we are in a very dangerous situation. And we have to recognize that the resilience of American democracy relies on our defense of it. If we had any doubt, watching what's happened under this current president should leave no confusion that we have to fight for democracy. And my worry is that absent an active engagement, no, we're not going to get all of the resolution we need by 2020, but we can fight for it all now.
You know, let's get back to Stacey. We're talking politics, but I want to talk Stacey too. I like I said, I fell in love with your book. I plan to buy several copies, and I understand the book release was kind of muted because of some political reasons.
So I probably am the only person who was on the cover of Time magazine who had a book that did not have a correlative increase in sales. My opponent in the primary filed an ethics complaint challenging my ability to promote my book as a false campaign contribution. She said it was a violation of campaign finance rule. It wasn't, but in the midst of a heated primary, it's difficult to litigate all of these issues. And so we, as the better part of valor, pulled back on promotion of the book, which has been problematic for me. However, my publishers are very excited, so we're going to release it again. You can get it right now as Minority Leader at any of your booksellers, but they're going to release it again March 26th as Lead from the Outside, and it will be released by Picador in paperback
version. I'm not really excited about it. I think that not only should young women read it, but seasoned women as well. I picked up a couple lessons and things, and I just loved your transparency. One of the things that you talked about that I want to take a minute to talk about was your debt. And I heard you at the Rainbow Convention, you mentioned it there as well. Your opponent didn't mind throwing that out there that you were six figures in debt and how dare you run for office when you also owed money, as if three quarters of America does not owe money. Talk to me a little bit about that debt and why we should be concerned about it.
So at the time I was running, I had tax debt. I had an outstanding 2 years where I owed back taxes, which I was paying. I was in a payment agreement with the IRS like millions of Americans. And it came about because I have been one of the primary financial supports for my parents. My parents are raising my niece and they are both retired pastors. And before they were retired, they were low paid Methodist ministers. And so I've been responsible for their health insurance, their basic living expenses for several years. But I was also self-employed. And there was a moment where my self-employment and their expenses did not quite meet. And one of the places where I could access the resources I needed was to defer paying my taxes. I never failed to report, and I've consistently made payments, but I got into debt, and a lot of us do, because my dad has prostate cancer. You can defer your taxes. You cannot defer cancer treatment payments.
Three quarters of us are in debt, and 10% of us owe more than six figures.
Yes.
So you're not unusual. Yeah. Talk a little bit about the debt trap in America.
Part of what happens is that our real wages are not rising, but costs are rising. And for me, you know, I want to be very clear. I've lived a very economically privileged life for the last 20 years. Graduating from Yale Law School has given me amazing opportunities, but I still face real challenges. And having aging parents and a growing niece who's young, children are expensive. Life is expensive, and the reality is that wages in America do not often keep pace with cost. And particularly for communities of color, for women, the challenges become amplified.
And first generation. You know, I mean, not that you're first generation college, but you're first generation six-figure income.
Yes,
and exactly. So you're paying off student loans and all that good stuff. And
the way I phrase it is, look, we got a good job. Like, one person might get it, but when that happens,
we got a good job,
and you become the banker for your family. You become the solution because banks aren't available and credit isn't available, but challenges are always available.
You know, one of the other things you talk about in your book, and this always, women always get caught up in this, or we get caught in the trap of appearance and, yes. You know, what we look like, how we show up mm-hmm. and perform. And you're very, very candid about, you know, people thought that you might be gay because you weren't married.
Yes.
People talked about your size issues. Mm-hmm. That had to be hurtful.
Yes, and if you go on Twitter, it could be debilitating, so I don't read that. But the reality is, yes, I am a heavyset Black woman who doesn't date a lot. I am heterosexual, but I'm also a very outspoken ally of the LGBTQ community. And I don't think any of these things are disqualifying. I think it's the responsibility of a leader to be authentic in who she is. And, you know, I'm a natural hair, dark-skinned Black woman who is not a size 2, and yes, I'm capable of being a leader in our country. And what I would say is, why should anyone be disqualified because of how they look? The question is, what can you do?
Precisely.
And are you willing to do it?
So you're there shattering stereotypes. I want to read something President Obama said about you. He said, at a time when too many people are focused simply on how to win an election, Stacey's someone who cares about something more important, why we should. That's the kind of politics we should practice. That's why I'm proud to give Stacey Abrams my support. How'd you feel when you got that?
It was extraordinary. He is a seminal leader, a singularity, not just because of how he won and what he represented, but what he did with that office. His willingness to speak, not just truth as power, but to lift up other voices. I worked with President Obama during the time I was Democratic leader because of the work that we were able to do together on criminal justice reform and on employment of ex-offenders. And I will say that, you know, in my lifetime, there has been no stronger president.
So give us some scoop. We're running out of time. You got to give me something that you haven't given anybody else. What's the secret, Stacey?
Secret to what?
Secret to the audacity. Where'd you get that boldness from?
My parents. I like to say I'm a perfect mix of Robert and Carolyn Abrams. My dad is fearless. He will do anything, say anything, often in front of the wrong people. But he raised us to believe you don't tell yourself no, you let other people tell you no. But he also said, if you don't try, how will you know? My mother is brilliant, and she's not cautious, but she's studied. And she was the one who taught me that you meet people where they are, not where you want them to be. And that it's my responsibility to go and find the things I want, not to wait for them to arrive. And by being able to mix the two of them, I've become who I am, and I'm very grateful to both of them for making me me.
And the transparency. Every politician, your book reminds me a little bit of Michelle Obama's book.
That's a very high compliment.
Well, the transparency, the fact that you're not afraid just to put it out there.
Here, politics is difficult to us. We're asking people to trust us with their lives. My responsibility is to make sure they know who I am when I'm asking them to trust me. And the reality is, it's easier to believe someone when they know who you are because they are part of who you are. I have debt. I have challenges. I'm not all that great at dating all the time. There are ways, but no,
nobody is.
Exactly. And my point is, the extent to which we elevate people beyond the stratosphere of accessibility, we rob them of the belief that you care about their real issues. And politics is about real issues. People need to know that you care about whether they can make their next rent payment. They need to know that you care about their child coming out of jail trying to get a good job. And they need to know that you care about who they are because they know who you are.
So 2018 was the year of Black Girl Magic, and Stacey Abrams, you were part of that Black Girl Magic. I'm sorry that you're not in the governor's mansion, but I know we're going to hear more from you, not only because you've got this new book tour coming, but also because you really have proven that you are indeed a political leader. It's just been a delight and an honor to have you on to talk not only about your politics, but also about that inner Stacey. Thanks for being with me.
Thank you so much for having me. I enjoyed being your first guest.
Thank you.